Hello everyone, good morning and good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Rigo Vela, Community Manager on the Cisco Learning Network, and I'll be your host for this webinar today. In this session, we will be covering Cisco ICE for SD Access with our speaker and presenter, Ruben Maya. But before we get started, I wanted to share a couple of quick housekeeping notes. First, I do want to let our attendees know that our presenters are currently working from home. So if we do run into any technical issues during the webinar, we'll do our very best to resolve it as soon as possible. So we just want to thank you in advance for your patience and understanding. Next, if you have any questions during the session, we ask that you please post them in the question and answer panel, as that will help our panelists keep track of all of your questions and would also allow them to provide you with a much more timely response. Also, if you experience any audio issues during the live presentation, I do recommend using the call-in telephone number that I will be posting in the chat window here again momentarily. And at the end of this webinar, you will get a pop-up survey with a couple of questions about today's presentation, and we would really appreciate it if you could just take a moment to fill it out and share with us any thoughts or feedback that you may have. And I also want to let our attendees know that this session will be recorded and it will be available for on-demand viewing within about 5 business days after today, and I'll be sure to post some more information on that in the chat window a little bit later on. And last but not least, I wanted to let everyone know that we will be launching a few poll questions throughout this presentation, and when we are ready to launch one of these polls, we will announce it live, and then we'll make once we launch it, it'll pop up on your webinar event screen, and then that's when you'll have an opportunity to submit your answers. So we hope that you all can participate. And without further delay, I'm now going to turn it over to our presenter to get the webinar started. So, Ruben, if you're ready, please take it away.
Thank you, Rigo. I'll be sharing my screen. All right. So, hello everyone, thanks for joining today's session. And today our topic will be about Identity Services Engine for software-defined access. So we will cover basically the integration of these two products and what are the benefits upon this integration. My name is Ruben Maya, I'm a customer success specialist. I'm focused on Cisco secure portfolio. So anything that is secure technology related, it's my job to do. Before we continue, I want also to address some housekeeping items here. So during today's session, you will have the opportunity to ask any questions you might have about this Identity Services Engine and software-defined access, or about IS in general. Just type your questions into the Q&A panel, which you'll find on the right side of your screen, or you can find the hand icon to raise your hand or outline the panelists will respond. So we'll do ask you to lower your hand once your question has been answered. For unanswered questions, there will be a live Q&A in the end of today's session. And if you have any audio issues, please use the chat window and one of our panelists will try to assist you. So I would like to begin our session today by addressing this question. So how does IS integration with software-defined access speed up a network segmentation that we know that is a critical foundation for a zero trust network these days? So hopefully after today's session, you'll get an idea and you get an answer towards this question. Without any further ado, I'm going to present you today's agenda. So first of all, we are going to take a look at IAC and software defined access in a quick nutshell. So we're going to do an overview where I will talk about the solution and touch a bit on the features and concept. Then we will dive into IAC's role in software defined access. Afterwards, we will touch on the integration procedure, followed by the segmentation part. And to wrap up, we'll have a demo that we will showcase the integration process and also the applying in practically the concept of the segmentation. And we also have a treat for you today. As a bonus, we will also have some quickly troubleshooting tips that you may run into any issue while you're integrating these two solutions. So stick till the end. Next to the Q&A panel, we'll have that special small topic about those typical issues. And again, during this session, feel free to ask any question to our panelists. They are here today to help us answering those. So keep that in mind. Okay, let's then proceed with Cisco IAC, Identity Services Engine, and talk about the overview of IAC. To begin with, IAC, as I mentioned before, it will be a nutshell approach. IAC is a network access control and policy enforcement platform. So basically, with this platform, we are controlling any single type of access that we have in our network and applying a policy upon that type of access. So if you mind, I'll use here the laser pointer. So we are trying to address all these answers upon a session start and someone tries to connect to our network access device. We are trying to address these 8 questions all the time. So who, what, when, where, how, the health of that endpoint, any potential threats it may have, or CVS-based score upon some posture checks that can be done on the device. So with all these results, we are trying to give you this concept of visibility. So we want to see users, endpoints, and applications. You want to make sure that we have secure access by controlling the network access and applying the segmentation. As I can see on the right, we are defining access policies for endpoints or for the network based on how the network is accessed, wired, wireless VPN, and then applying some control, either role-based access control, guest access, BYOD, secure access. And at the same time, we are also sharing this context with partners for innocent operations. When I mention here partners, I'm talking about our Cisco security portfolio that we are able to communicate over PXGrid and REST APIs. And here we are talking about CM systems, MDM, IPSs. So from our product line, for instance, we are talking about integrating our FMC, StealthWatch, M4 endpoints, other solutions, you name it. As long as there's a PXGrid and API communication, we are able to establish that connection, as we'll see later. Let's now take a look more over about the contents of the solution. So IAC itself has an internal database that can store a lot of users. We can store up till, we will discuss in a bit about scalability, but just to mention that IAC has an internal database that can store data, but also can integrate with other external identity stores. For instance, LDAP or SQL, we have, in terms of scalability, we support 250 distinct AD domain support. So Active Directory, for instance, PostgreSQL. And in the other side of the house, to the left side, we are also instructing our network access devices, so switches, wireless and controllers, firewalls, which type of protocols can be used to be authenticating on the network, and then passing that information to the endpoint that is directly connected to those network access devices. Again, talking about scalability, we support up to 2 million concurrent sessions, up to 100K network devices. As I mentioned before, that IAC has an internal database that can support up till 300K internal users. And not only that, but we also have the ability of having ICE as our CA with the built-in CA capability, or also delegate it on a SCAP format, so we can also have ICE acting through a SCAP connection for the certificate authority to get certificate-based authentication, or we can also have IAC, as you probably know, as just intermediary CA, for instance. Also, through APIs, you communicate with identity providers over XML in the cloud for the single sign-on operations. We support a lot of vendors. Moreover, Azure, Duo, and Okta that are commonly used these days. So we provide that flexibility and that access. As I mentioned before, for the write side that we delegate instructions to our network devices, we here in this part, we delegate in two ways. I will begin with authentication methods and then proceed to authorization options. So for the authentication methods, for the passive identity, we do MAC authentication bypass, or MAP for short. We do the Easy Connect. And for the active identity, of course, we have the .1x, we have the web authentication with CWA, Central Web Auth, or local web authentication. And then when the user are authenticated for authorization options, we may push some downloadable ACL, we may apply some airspace ACL, VLAN assignment, security group tags, or SGTs as we're going to see today, URL redirection, or some port configuration that is directly applied over some interface template directly on the port of the network device. All right, and with all these operations and capabilities, what we try to give you is a way that you can make fully informed decisions. So we spend a lot of time these days to respond and define effective security policies with adequate context. And if you're practicing security without the context, it's static, it's ineffective, and can be easily compromised. From a security perspective, an IP address for me tells me nothing, as you can see on the left. It tells me absolutely nothing. But with ISC, I have an enrichment of context. And again, it relies on the questions that I mentioned before that we get visibility on. So we know always what's happening. We know the who authenticated. We can see that Bob authenticated, what he authenticated in terms of endpoint, when was the authentication happening, where he was located, what was the method of authenticating to the network, what apps is he using on his laptop, and then we can even go towards some extra MDM enforcement if you wish so, and then based on all this information that we can collect, authorize him or not to have network access. So all these things can translate in what Bob will have access granted on at a later stage. Okay, before we jump into the software-defined access part, I'll stop here and I'll call Rigo to introduce our first polling question for today.
Awesome, thank you, Ruben. All right, so we are ready to launch the first poll. And this one is actually a two-question poll. For the first question, we're wondering, what's the version of ICE in your production? And then for the second question, what's the version of DNAC in your production? All of the available answer options are presented to you on screen there. And as soon as I open up the official poll, it'll pop up on your screen, and then you'll have an opportunity to submit your answers. So thank you so much in advance for your participation. Back to you, Ruben.
Thanks, Rigo. All right, so as I was mentioned, we will now start our brief overview around software-defined access. And I want to begin with this diagram here to illustrate you what will be the interactions and the gains between these two systems. So first of all, we are automating the configuration on DNA Center. So here exactly goes for the second topic of automated network fabric. And then later on, with the assurance, we are able to monitor the current status of the network devices, clients, applications, and we can also achieve all of this with authentication and identity-based policies that are given through IEC. So we are able to decouple the security policy definition from a VLAN and an IP address. We are passing this automation through DNA. And at the end of the day, if we need to answer to some issue, we have always analytics and insights that can give us some user and application behavior that we can tackle down and quickly answer in the moment that the issue is happening. And that will reply to the premise that what happened before was the networks were getting more complex and it was taking longer to get people onboarded. You know, it was difficult to get the people with the right network access and with the right credentials. Today, we also live in a CLI-driven world that allows us to define consistent policy, but just one time, yes. With the SDA, we can associate the policy to the specific group with no dependency on the VLANs and IP addresses. And we can define also one consistent policy that will follow the user from the edge to the cloud. And we don't need to, at the same time, we don't need to deal with policy violations or those errors manually. As we see, it's like it's completely automated. It's the group-based policies, and the policy will follow this identity. So what we have before is we have VLANs and IP address based. We could create IP based on ACLs for access policy, and then we have to deal with these violations and errors manually. What we get with the SDA access is that no VLAN or subnet dependency for segmentation access control will be required. We can define one consistent policy that will follow us from, let's say, from wireless to wired and vice versa. And if it's attached to me, for instance, attached to Ruben, where Ruben will authenticate, that this policy will follow me. And that is what I want also to explain with this scenario here, that we have a consistent wired and wireless management, thanks as well to that capability of the following. Because one of the common complaints when it comes to IT is that we need to have a specific policy set for wired and then a specific policy set for wireless. But with SDA, again, not only does the policy you set follow the user, it provides the consistent management across the wired and wireless through a single fabric for the campus-wide roaming and at the same time, a simple provisioning. So taking a look on the image before, we had to do repeated tasks of creating these policies for wired and wireless. We had some issues on roaming on L3 domains. And then we had to chase down this IP address for troubleshooting, which these days is not feasible. With the SDA access, again, we have this consistent transition. We have some optimal traffic flows with seamless roaming. And it's also seamlessly roaming in fabric and non-fabric domains. So we have always this consistency across campus-wide. Okay, and now you may ask how these components work together. So for the Cisco SDA access, the solution components that will be required and we'll touch not just on this slide but across the full presentation will have Cisco DNA Center as our central point of network design, provision and assurance that has the network controller platform, which is the fabric and non-fabric automation and orchestration. And then we have the NDP, the network data platform, that will be the data collection and analytics of system. That will also be, this NDP will also be one of the subscribers that we have on IAC for the event. We'll have Cisco IAC for the identity-based access that will play a major role here. And we also have what we call the Campus Fabric, which is the new approach of building enterprise networks these days. So all of these components will interact between all the solution, and we'll see what is actually IAC doing, what is actually IAC role in the SD access. So what can be IAC use cases for SD access, where IAC can be interacting? So IAC in use cases with software-defined access, we have the possibility of doing, for the guest access, guest network automation. We also have the host onboarding, so for user and device authentication. We have the group-based policies for the software-defined access segmentation that we'll see later to the end of the demo. And we also have the assurance or with the client 360, where we can get all the parts towards health checks and client health and so on to address those questions. As I mentioned before, if we have a problem, we can in real time contact the host and resolve an issue. In the scheme of things, these are the communications that will be done on the normal deployment. When we have the connection with DNA, with DNA center, with the SDA parts, and IAC primary panels, they will talk a lot between them, really a lot. You will see a lot of this communication in your IAC live logs that is happening between DNA and ICE. For getting any kind of new update, we'll be constantly looking for new information to be addressed between these two systems. And at the same time, IAC will be also sending SXP information to any other device that we may have configured. Over PX3, we will be sending also updates for the subscribers. So can be a WSA, a Firepower, an ASA, or any third-party integration. At the same time, the policies are being contacted as well. So any new session that is starting from the edge, any authentication, authorization that is being sent here over radios to the PSNs, will also have the segmentation policies being downloaded directly to the final endpoint. So we have all this communication going and rolling. And I will go through the big picture of things of each single component step by step on the next slide. And I organized here the components with a naming that also has a naming on the DNA side. So here when I, for instance, here when I mention AAA network and AAA endpoints and users, it's also mapped to the same component that you see on the DNA center interface. So here, and we will go through all these topics, but here is to mention that there are two ways to do it and how we do it. And then we'll go through the device profiling, guest access, and all the other options in order to guide you through every single stage that is happening on the system. So I'll begin with AAA network. On AAA network, we usually configure only AAA network for device administration. So here we can either use radios on TACACS, but AAA network will be always to configure network devices. So we are trying here to push to configure the DNA center to automatically push the network configuration to the devices. So we have a terminal user that is connecting either over Telnet, SSH, serial connection to a network access device, and then over TACACS or radius, we are contacting ISC, and we are verifying for that user if he can actually perform those commands, so granting them the command authorization on that device, and then pushing those configured automated profiles from DNA Center, the templates. Of course, on the same fashion, we'll have for the endpoints and users. The endpoints and users, we are configuring actually here the access control for the network access. And here is where we support .onyx or MAV, MAC authentication bypass. And here we have the network devices that were automatically configured by the DNA center. And we have our final users, the endpoints, establishing sessions to those devices. And we are already on those endpoints giving authorization options, such as virtual network assignment, VLAN assignment, scalable group tag, or SGTs, and others. So they already receive and being authenticated through the network devices that were already automatically configured by DNA Center. Also, we have the asset visibility from the IEC device profiling. So, as you know, IEC profiling relies on the data that is collecting from the network, and IEC starts to use this information to begin to build a database of all the endpoints and includes all the attributes as well that is learning from them. So as IEC continues to collect this profiling data, it will also try to attempt to classify the endpoints, give them an endpoint profile that describes what the device is. And you can see here on the image that we have a few endpoints that were detected on our environment and they were classified by their endpoint profile. So for instance, we have here three network devices. We have a switch, we have a wireless and controller or access point, and we have a VPN termination. And we have here what we call the device sensors that are collecting data. And here we rely on the Any Connected Entity extension for getting the endpoint information. And we are classifying, for instance, that we have Alice accessing over the VPN. We have John that is using his MacBook. We have an IP phone. We have an IP camera. And all this information is collected by the attributes that you see on the top right. So we have active probes, we have device sensor probes, and we have AnyConnect probes. All those probes together will be the ones that will give this information to IEC, so IEC can build that endpoint database. And we also rely on our feed service to also update the definitions and the dictionaries of these endpoints. So we can actually rely even more in a bigger MAC address database or other attributes, either from the HTTP agent you mentioned, yes? As long as there's a new dictionary entry to be added, the feed service will provide with the latest information. Other thing that is quite normal to deploy with IEC is IEC guest features. And we are here to talk about the guest part because we have also a use case that we'll see on the next slide about automating software-defined access for the guest access. And as we have three ways that we can deploy the guest portals, hotspot, as you know, immediate and credential internet access, self-register, either by the guest or a sponsor that may approve the access, or the sponsored guest with the authorized sponsor that creates an account and shares the credentials. We have a lot of a big amount of accounts that are supported, over 1 million. We have different ways to share these credentials, as you know, email, print, or SMS. We can customize it. We can use ICE Portal Builder to customize it. And we can manage all of these things with REST API, which is quite nice to mention about REST API, because REST API is also one of the components that is used for programmability between IAC and DNA, and is also something that is going to be used with SDA access for the guest access automation. So again, we support the three based access types. So hotspot, again, self-registered and sponsored. With the DNA center automation, we can do guest virtual network creation. We can automate the guest SSID creation. We can use, as I mentioned, the portal builder customization. So we can customize those portals with the templates or, you know, HTML code. We can also automate the IAC authorization policies. And then later on with the assurance, we have the possibility to have an health status of our wireless infrastructure. We can take a look on our client onboarding, and we can also do sensor testing for instance, for guest SSID tests to IAC and ClearPass. So here we can also rely on those insights, as I mentioned earlier, on SDA insights to get this assurance data as well and tackle down any issues that the clients might have when onboarding, for instance, our guest portals. Okay, I'll pass now the ball back to Rico for the results of the first poll and the next question.
Thank you, Ruben. All right, so before I open up our next poll, I'm just going to share the results from the previous two questions in poll number one. And as a reminder, the question was, what's the version of ICE in your production? And the results show that a high majority of participants are using 2.6 and 2.7. Then the next group said to be using version 2.4. And then for the second question, what's the version of DNAC in your production? Let's see here. The results indicate that the top answer that the participants are using or actually have not deployed DNAC and SD access. And then this is followed by the version greater than 1.3.3.9.
Okay, good. Then it will be very productive for those. So you mind going with the question three?
Absolutely. All right. So for the poll number two, in our third question, this is, are you already using ICE TrustSec feature for software-defined access control? And for the answers, you can select yes, no, we are testing the feature, or not using but have a requirement. So I'm going to launch the question right now, and we hope you can participate by submitting your answer. Thank you, and back to you, Ruben.
Thank you, Rigo. Okay, so in the next section, we will dig a bit about the IAC and DNA Center integration. And we will touch base with all the components that are required to successfully achieve this integration. So on the big picture on the scheme of things, as we verified so far, it's important to understand that Identity Services Engine, or IAC, is the key component with Cisco DNA Center providing intent services like AAA, and we are talking about radios and TACACs, visibility, onboarding, security, and macro and micro segmentation. But to leverage these services correctly, we need to perform the Cisco DNA Center and IAC integration and establish the trust between these two entities. So we'll touch base on the components right now. For the information exchange that will happen, so IAC deployment and persons for automation purposes. We'll also exchange information about scalable groups and policies, add network devices, portals, authorization policies on ICE, etc. And also IP pools to virtual network mappings, and etc. So all this information will be exchanged upon this integration, and to start building this integration, we need to start by establishing the trust. So the trust is established usually by configuring the SSH part, do the negotiation of the SSH. Then we have the REST API that plays also a role here that we need to use and enable on both systems, on IC, to be able to get the programmability part. And then with the PXQB enabled, we'll have the context intersect metadata sharing. So for all these steps, we'll begin with the secure shell, so SSH. And Cisco DNA Center has a requirement that it requires Cisco IAC admin username and password when it connects to Cisco IaC to authenticate the access. So for that, the GUI and CLI credentials must be identical from IAC side. And you have an example of that on the right side. So we have the CLI example and of the GUI example that we are using similar password. From our documentation and release notes on ICE, from ICE 3.0, there's a link below. You can also see that from Cisco DNA Center release 2.2.1.0 onwards, the use of Cisco IAC CLI has been dropped, and the CLI admin and username, admin username and password doesn't require it to be the same. So we are skipping this step here. Other component that is also required is the REST API, as I mentioned. So here we are talking about representational state transfer or REST or RESTful web services. That this is a way to provide interoperability between computer systems and the internet in the general approach to REST. Moreover, talking about these two systems, specifically DNA and ICE, we are using external RESTful services, APIs, to communicate CRUD operations. As you can see, we can do get, post, delete, and put methods. And we are using this communication over the port 960. And we are passing these communications and this programmability part to the other side. Also, other thing that plays an important role here is the PXRead services. And to give you a general idea about PXRead, you probably talk about PXRead a lot on these webinars. But again, PXRead provides you a unified framework that enables ecosystem partners to integrate with PXRead. And we can see here these partners on the bottom right. So I put here a lot of things that can be considered as these integrations as subscribers. And here we are changing the context from IAC to those devices. So we have here the controller, which is the PXRead node in the center. We have also our publisher. So here will be the empty node talking with PXRead and publishing any type of information that is required. And then we have the subscriber that can be other system that is mentioning here. We are publishing topics and sharing context over those topics. For instance, for the today's integration, what we are sharing over context exchange is the following information. So, and we are talking here about the subscribers that we have under the client management on IAC. So for the DNAC, for Cisco DNA Center, we have two subscribers. One subscriber would get information about the RESTsec Security Group, and the second subscriber will be for the NDP. As we saw before, for the network data platform, we'll have information such as the profiler, ANC status, so adaptive network control, TrustSec security groups, sessions, the bindings of SXP and the session group. And also something that I want to point out here is that the interface changed. So if you are used to see this menu or any version 1, version 2 X-Train, now on ICE 3.0 it's located under client management, under clients. So you need to go to administration security services, select client management, and then you have the clients to see their status, if they are enabled, if you want to disable them, if you want to approve, in case that you don't have auto-approval enabled, or decline. This is the where they are located, the list of your clients, and where you will manage them, your PXRead clients. Okay, and as a picture of what was covered during this section, to establish the interoperability between these two platforms, on the first block, we spoke about SSH. So we are configuring ICE parameters on DNA Center, and then the DNA Center is opening the SSH connection to IAC to initiate the trust establishment. And we can see how the communication is being done. After the trust is established, we are able to start negotiating over PXGrid. So DNA Center connects to ICE via PXGrid, and then we start to download TrustSec metadata. Example, scalable groups. They have been downloaded from IAC. And then as a last step for the REST API, so for the programmability part, DNA Center will send the REST API calls, fetch the brownfield TrustSec policies, and then, of course, they are downloaded into the DNA site, ready to be used and consumed. How does it look in the sense of interoperability, in the sense of the segmentation? So for the segmentation part, and here we are considering on the left, anything that will connect on the edge. So when we are accessing IAC services for authentication authorization, we are already establishing that a client that will be coming from the edge receive an SGT with a virtual network. From the DNA Center, we have the ability to create groups that will have a specific restriction in the network or a specific type of access. And also we can denote protected apps and services. And at the same time, we'll see in the demo, at the same time, we'll have this control to access that is going to be applied to a user. So we can, for instance, have two users on the edge, sitting on the edge, and they will belong to the same group, but they will have different SGTs applied. And SGTs can be based on the following attributes on the left. So we can apply based on user and device identity, on location, on profile, on posture, etc. In the end of the day, it would look like this. We have two virtual networks, campus user and building systems, and then we have users there with their specific SGTs applied. And we don't hear when we are talking about macro segmentation, we are doing at the virtual network level based on VRFs. We have also different VNs that should not communicate. And when we are talking about the micro, we are within one virtual network. It's as well based on SGTs, like this example here. And they are able to communicate between them based on role-based permissions. So in the case that they actually have some role-based access that they can speak to each other, they will. If not, they will not, basically. Okay, and about the propagation and about the SXP and the exchanging protocol, here I have distinguished here the the two flows about the SXP and radios. And here we are doing between SXP, between ISC and Border Fusion, we are doing inter-VN filtering, multi-site with IP transit with end-to-end segmentation, and at the same time, for any of those examples, Fusion devices will need an other radio session to be based on IP SGT mappings. And that information then will be passed over SXP to those Fusion devices. Okay, this slide here is to reflect what we covered so far about the integration. And here is when we already have the two systems integrated, we can just go to scalable groups on DNA Center, create a new scalable group. Then these new SGTs will be sent to IAC via DRS or REST API. And any DNA Center admin can input something, like you can assign a network device to a location site, you can create a new CTS policy, you can configure guest, and it's followed by the any time that he does any of those operations, they always followed by a REST API call to update IAC config accordingly. So if I wish to create a new network device and add this network device from the DNA side into IAC, I'll configure that in DNA Center, and that information then afterwards will be communicated to IAC, for instance. When I spoke at the beginning about the software-defined access possibilities as well, we spoke about client health and assurance. And for instance, this is a screenshot of the wired assurance, that the information that we can get from a client with IAC. So as you can see in the image on the top, if we don't have the IAC integration, we'll have just some information. We don't have, for instance, we don't have identity following, we don't have identification on the host name, any domain information, profiling will lack, and IAC can complement those areas and give that visibility at the same time applying the enforcement. As we can see here, we have this specific endpoint that is, he has a VLAN attached to it. We can see the device type. We can see that this is a session that is connected. IP address is MAC address. Who is the user? So the identity and the domain name from that machine. So we always have, we can then rely to apply more informed decisions based on these outcomes from the integration. Okay, we have a demo section. We have a demo section for the integration part, and I'll briefly talk about this integration part on the scenario that we have here. Just a moment. All right. So what we will do on this first initial demo, we already have these systems integrated, but we want to showcase what were the steps that we cover on the slides that are required to be configured on IAC before we move into the integration. So what I will first showcase to you is what we need to have enabled on IAC in order to make all these systems cooperate, let's say. So first of all, we need to have SSH configured. Again, on this part in time, if you've been connecting and configuring since day zero IAC, you probably already have SSH enabled. So, but if not, if you're still using any other type of connection, you can check your status for the SSH service. So for instance, we'll connect here on the console and check here for if we have SSH enabled. The demos. We can even do show ports include SSHD, for instance, to see if it's running. In case that it is not running, you can just do config T and we can just do service SSHD enabled if it's the case that we require to enable it. And this will be our first initial step to verify it. And we can just check on those parts. Important to keep is that the password there that when I authenticated to my CLI is exactly the same that I'm using on my QIC portal, so on the GUI. Other important step that we need to verify is, in this case, we're going to use our Cisco Identity Services as our CA. So for that, we want to check under our administration system certificates if we have everything that is required to be in place. So in this case, we want to verify if our certificate authority is up and running. So internal CA settings, we can see that our service for CA is up and running and functioning properly. And since we are also in this page, we also want to take a look on the templates. So in case that we have the PXGrid certificate rolling, we want to make sure that the template, when we are defining SCAP Registry Authority profile, we are using ISA's internal CA. We want to make sure that this is also validated. And as well, we want to make sure that on the deployment, we have at least one node. In this case, we have two nodes, but at least one node serving PXRead service. So we want to make sure that we have PXRead enabled and running, up and running as a requirement. And the last step that we will verify here from IAC side is on the settings, IRS settings for REST API, and make sure that we have enabled ERS for read and write, and for the nodes as read if you're doing multiple nodes. And in case that you want to do cross-site reforging checks, you want to have this option enabled, just in case. And moreover, this is everything, every single step that we need to prepare on IAC before we jump into the DNA side. Because when we jump on the DNA side, to avoid any issues, we already have that information in place, configured and in order. We're just going to authenticate on DNA and go to the page where we need to have our IAC as AAA server. Let's just give a brief moment to this to authenticate. All right. So on DNA, we'll go here to extend our menu, system, and then here we'll go to settings, and you're going to pick external services, authentication and policy servers. And we already have here, as I mentioned, this is an integration already done to save you time because this process may take time. And we're going to just briefly go through what we configured for our IAC node here. In case you don't have, you'll need to add as a new one. We're going to edit this one. And here what we defined as the attributes, we defined here our IAC PAN node. And from here, you can only define one instance of IAC. When I mean one instance, I mean one deployment. Doesn't matter if you have the maximum of the 50 nodes. You can only put here the primary administration node IP address. And here is the shared IP shared secret that you use with IAC network access devices. Then you enable for Cisco IAC server. You put your credentials like you use authenticate on your CLI and GUI. Full qualified domain if you have. You have to enter here a full qualified domain name for the panel. Then define a name for the subscriber that will appear under client registrations on our IAC to subscribe to the PXN event. And then if it's the case that you have a load balancer, you may also want to have here, and you are doing redirection of radios and TACACS traffic, you may want to add here on the VIP part the load balancers. And then you can define on the advanced settings as well which protocols you will use. In this case, we are just using here the radios one, but if you want to do as well TACACS, you can also deploy TACACS and then save that configuration. Once the configuration is saved and the entry is added here, you will see the status passing to active. And then later on, if you go to System 360, scroll down to externally connected systems, you need to offer the successful integration. Every status here as green, as it shows, and this will grant you that you have fully established the communication between these two systems. Also, at this time, while the synchronization happens, you probably be able as well, when you go to the policy group based access control, to start seeing here your TrustSec matrix and start to see like the groups that you have deployed before on IAC. I want to mention just one thing here. If you click here on GBAC configuration, you can see that currently is DNA the owner of the configuration. So any changes will be done on the DNA side and IAC will be on read-only. The same is if you now go to IAC and you go to the menu, Work Centers, TrustSec, you will see a warning that DNA Center is now managing the TrustSec security groups. And these screens are just in read-only, so you cannot edit. But in some case that you want to override it, there's also an option on IAC under general TrustSec settings that you can override the DNA Center control of trust policy by clicking on this option. You can still edit on IAC side. So you still have the control to edit. All right, now we have this established, the system connection established. We want to test how easy it is to deploy a policy. So we actually have a policy in place for employees, when I have two employees that are introduced to IAC. So we have John and Alice. And I can give an example of that, of those users. So if you go here to administration and identities, I have here two users, Alice and John, that we're going to use for this example, that they belong to the employees group. And we are applying to them a specific SGT. So if you go here to policy, so I'm just going to showcase you what we are applying as a profile to these users. So for authorization profile for these users, we are giving them a specific security group called employees, belongs to the virtual network composition, and has a specific pool name address to them. What we'll do is from John's side, as you saw, it was green. From John's side, we will try to ping Alice because, as you may wonder from the matrix, from the matrix here, we are permitting communications between them. So we are able to ping between those two machines. And this is just to give you an idea how easy it is to deploy TrustSec. So just give me a moment, because I was disconnected here on my side. Apologies for that.
Hey, Ruben, sorry to interrupt. Just for awareness, we are at the top of the hour, so just for your awareness.
Yeah, thanks, Rigo.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I just got disconnected here. So basically, just quickly, let's go quickly here to the sessions. So we have here, some users connected. I'll showcase you just quickly here. We have a few sessions connected. So we have John connected, and we have Alice. John sits on the 11th, and Alice sits on the 10th. We're just going to copy this. And for instance, here we have John. We are going to ping. We are going to ping this user. And we are able to. But if we wish so, if we wish to completely negate this, we could, easy as this, change this contract and, for instance, deny the ACMP part, so we cannot ping between them. Save this change. We are now doing the communication. We now need to do the deploy of this policy as easy as it can be. And let me just move the window back. Okay. And if we try again simply to ping the other machine, we should be unable to perform that operation. It was simple as that we can apply a control and roll over our segmentation controls. Okay. All right. So, Rigo, passing the ball back to you just for the results, and then we'll close with the bonus section of the troubleshooting.
Yes, thank you. So I'll now share the results from the poll number 2. So the question was, are you already using ICE TrustSec feature for software-defined access control? And from this feedback, I can see that for the top answer, our participants said no to using TrustSec feature at this time. And then for the second top answer down the line, we have those who said that they are testing the feature.
Okay, great. And for the last question, I'll introduce that one. So do you agree that it's simple to use group access space control from SDA access? Answers are yes, it's simple to configure. No, I feel comfortable with ACLs. Not sure I need more info. Okay, as I mentioned before, as a small treat, there is usually some integration issues that may happen in the beginning, and usually we never think about that it can be L2 or L3 driven, and we start as engineers to complicate things. So to begin with, a good thing that you may want to do in the beginning is to check your firewall. If you see any blocks, any ports being blocked by the firewall, you can take the packet capture with TCP dump, or you can even use the maglev to check if you can attach to a service and check the TCP state connection, verify if there is any block in the middle. Other one is usually ICE proxy configuration. As you know, when we are establishing the connection between these two systems, if there is a proxy configured in the middle, this connection will fail. how we can find this on IACPS ULOC. There's a step on this communication that will tell you why it failed. And if you go to IAC documentation on the segmentation part on 3.0, for instance, you can see that we have this on our documentation that states that verify if IAC is not using a proxy. If it is, please exclude DNA IP from the proxies. So there's this thing that you can do in settings to bypass the proxy. You may want to add those domains and IP addresses there just to make sure that we have communication. And the thing that may happen is when doing ERS calls, we are returning some HTTP error code. Usually, this might mean a problem on IAC, and it should be debugged on IAC by using the CA service and CA admin debugs. Those components and also correlate with IACPS logs. You can also do it on Magliv with the service logs minus R design. Technically speaking, most of these cases, the solution is to regenerate the root CA chain on IAC, but I'll tell you, you should not do this blindly, and you should identify the root case first, and if possible, open a service ticket with TAC and identify those with appropriate logs and screenshots. That will be amazing if you can do that. And to wrap up before we get into the Q&A, I just want to state that, as we saw today with the SDA, not only does the policy you set follow the user, but it also, you know, provides you consistent management and consistent policy management across wired and wireless, for instance. On top of that, we also saw the benefit of tagging the traffic using SGTs, learn from ICE, and then we can automate the segmentation and the group-based policies. This can really quickly speed up any deployment. And with the capability of the contextual insights, we are now also able to answer quickly and issue resolution at the same pace that we keep an eye on the network scaling. And last but not the least, with ERS and REST API, we have an open and programmable interface for integration and third-party solutions. So anything that can talk REST API can be used on that behavior. All right. And let's jump into the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ruben. Actually, it looks like our panelists have done an amazing job of just going through all of the questions that came in. So we actually don't have any remaining questions. So it looks like all of our audience inquiries have been addressed. So thank you so much to all of our panelists for just going in and just knocking all of those out. Really appreciate it.
In that regard, I will also want to mention about our resources then.
Sure.
We have ICE community resources, as you may know already. If you frequently come to our webinars, you already are familiar with these community resources. So we have a YouTube channel. We have a link for evaluations that you can check, integration guides. All that information can be checked through those links. As I mentioned, the YouTube channel. But since we spoke about DNA Center today, we also have the DNA Center community and resources, which I'm sharing here the links. And they also have a DNA Center YouTube channel. If you want to learn more about also SDA, DNA, and EN programmability, feel free to do so. They also have great content.
All right. Well, I think we'll go ahead and wrap it up. And thank you so much, Ruben, for speaking about the Cisco ICE for SD Access topic with our audience. I hope that everyone found great value in the information and resources that were shared here today. I would also like to extend a very big thank you to each and every one of our panelists for lending us a hand with all of the questions throughout the webinar. We really appreciate your help and support there. And just a quick reminder to our attendees that you will receive a short pop-up survey as soon as you exit the webinar. And we would be so grateful if you can just take a few minutes to complete it and just let us know how you liked today's presentation. We always look forward to receiving your valuable feedback. And again, for those of you who might be interested in revisiting this session, we will have the recording available for on-demand viewing within about 5 business days after today. For your reference, I went ahead and posted the link to our ICE training videos page in the chat window, and that's where the recording will be located. But just in case you missed it, I'm going to go ahead and post it again in just a moment. However, you will also be receiving an email within about 15 or 20 minutes that contains that very same link, so please do keep an eye on your email inbox for that. Thanks again to our presenter, Ruben, to our panelists, and to all of our attendees for joining us here live today. I hope that you all enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.